tonight, an encore presentation of our January 1991 interview with President Ronald Reagan. Next on Larry King Live.
Good evening. In view of the events yesterday and today regarding the injury to Ronald Reagan, we thought it appropriate that we replay our interview with the former president. We hope you find it interesting and enjoyable, and we wish him the very best.
Good evening from Los Angeles. Special night on Larry King Live. Our special guest, the former president of the United States, Ronald Reagan. Peace negotiation with Iraq seems hopelessly deadlocked. Over 500,000 United States men and women poised to sacrifice their lives in a Persian Gulf war. At home, a country divided. Strident hawks and vocal doves are back. Few men have faced the awesome task of guiding this nation through times like these. Ronald Reagan has been there. His own presidency endured problems in the Middle East, a Cold War, devastation of terrorism, survived it all. He's with us tonight, and next month he's going to be 80 years young. They're going to open the Reagan Library, and he's author of an autobiography, An American Life, from Simon & Schuster. The former President Ronald Reagan, a return visit to Larry King Live. Thank you for coming back.
Well, Larry, it's a pleasure to be here.
Well, let's get right to first things first before we reflect on that American life. Your thoughts on what's gone on today, yesterday, since August. How do you view all this?
Well, I think that it is it's really a situation that should capture everyone's interest. And I think that a lot of things are being overemphasized and maybe some of them underemphasized in this. First of all, the constant repetition of the United States versus Iraq and Saddam Hussein is overlooking the fact that it is the United Nations that is in this. We are there because the United Nations did what they were set up to do, and that is come to the rescue of a small country that was viciously assaulted and now faced with the possibility that only military action can bring about what it is that the United Nations has advocated and wants to see done. And I think that one of the arguments that's going on in our country with the Congress is helping Saddam Hussein. And that is that our Congress, and I hope within the next 48 hours or so this will be done, our Congress should pass a resolution that they will be behind the president if he has to take military action or not.
Do you agree, Mr. President, that they should debate it?
Well, but I do, if that's what it's going to take to get a vote from them. But what we need is to get rid of a situation that is now, I think, strengthening the stubbornness of Saddam Hussein. When he sees our government supposedly divided here between the Congress and the president. Now, if the Congress says yes, the commander-in-chief and so forth, and if he takes this action, we will be supportive of him.
What do you do, though, with this dilemma? And you've been someone who all your life has spoken out on issues. Ronald Reagan, when you were a Democrat, you spoke out. When you were a Republican, you were president. Whether you were in the Senate, whether you were rather governor of California, an actor, you spoke out. Shouldn't you, if you sit in the Senate tonight and you don't favor this, shouldn't you say so? Or are you saying no?
Well, I suppose that they have to argue and debate, but I would have to say to anyone who's sitting in that body and is disagreeing with regard to what must be done, if necessary, to change this situation, I'd do my best to persuade them they were on the wrong side.
Do you think they should not stand up? Or do you think they should disagree in private?
Well, they might disagree in private, but I think that our government has to recognize always, and sometimes I don't think it does. It has to recognize that we, the people, are in charge of this system and this country. We're unlike almost any nation on earth. And the representatives and the government employees and office holders work for the people. The employer is out there, the American people. And I think they should keep that in mind.
But the Senate also works for the people.
Yes. Oh, yes.
So we have to hear what they think, though, right?
Well, yes. But they should be guided a little bit also by what the people want.
It's fair to ask this. Would you have done what President Bush did? Would you have sent troops on that quickly after August 2nd?
Well, it's hard for me to answer that kind of a question of what would I have done, because only the person who's there has access to all the information and all every facet of it. And therefore, for someone to sit on the outside who hasn't had access to that information and try to make a decision comparing to someone else's. But as I've said, we have to view with some reason the fact that this was put up to the United Nations, and this is the type of thing that they were created to resolve. And the United Nations heard all the details and everything, and the United Nations did this. Other nations have 250,000 fighting men there in the Middle East along with ours. These other nations have contributed to the kind of running expenses of all of this of 80% of the cost. So it's not just the United States doing something.
Mr. President, your wife the other night in an hour here implied, I don't want to say she said directly, but she seemed a little angry at the fact that you are not being kept in daily touch of events here. If we can assume that, does it annoy you?
Well, I get notes and I get calls and so forth to a certain extent, but having been there, I understand also that you're so busy and a thing of that kind that you can't be doling out information all the time and everything that that comes up.
You mean it doesn't bother you then?
No, I wish I knew more about it, but I can also understand why they can't just take the time and trouble to do that.
How well do you think President Bush is handling it personally? I mean, as you view him, you just left that place.
yes, but I understand the situation he's in all of this, and I don't have any way of criticizing him.
Is the toughest thing about that job risking lives?
Well, I think that's one of the things that, of course, bothers you the most.
I mean, you're pressing a button.
Yes, and man, that's the greatest tragedy that happens to you, as I had it happen to me, with, for example, the terrorist act that killed 241 Marines in Lebanon. That was a great tragedy, and I tried to reach the families, the men who were lost and all, and talk to them, and it's the one thing that you just suffer the most.
You think we're going to go to war?
Well, as I say, I believe the United Nations in this situation has, if there is no other way, they have no choice. But here is a small country that was just openly invaded by a savage conqueror. Their civilian population has known great losses. People are being slaughtered. Women are being raped. Children are being killed and so forth. And I think the United Nations was created to stop outlaw countries from doing that to neighbors.
And do you think they will?
Well, yes, because I believe that there is no way that you can reject the use of force if it comes down to where that is the only means of straightening this out.
Our guest, the former President of the United States, Ronald Reagan, his autobiography, a bestseller from Simon & Schuster. The title, appropriately enough, An American Life. He'll be 80 years young next month, and as we say, only in America, you'll get the chance to talk to President Reagan after these words. Don't go away.
I think we should all recognize that these deeds make so evident the bestial nature of those who would assume power if they could have their way and drive us out of that area, that we must be more determined than ever that they cannot take over that vital and strategic area of the earth, or for that matter, any other part of the earth.
Monday on CNN and Time, they were victims of a massacre.
I stood up and I remember saying, I'm dead, I'm dead, I'm dead.
The gunman used a weapon that critics say was designed and marketed to appeal to violent people. Plus, at many of our universities, is justice a one-way street?
No one tells you that when you attend these schools, you're giving away your rights.
CNN and Time on CNN.
CNN covers the world for Latin America. With CNN en Español, the 24-hour Spanish language network that keeps the audience informed and up to date. Available across Latin America and in a growing number of cities in the United States, CNN en Español has all the news that matters most to Latin America, on air and online. When Latin Americans need the latest news, they turn to CNN en Español.
Over 20,000 stories and counting.
Hi, to reach out.
From Brazil.
Shanghai.
More than 200 broadcasters from over 130 countries.
CNN
all
World
brought
Report.
To you by one World newscast.
Report. CNN World Report.
CNN World Report, where journalists around the globe report the news as they see it. A unique perspective on international news. CNN World Report with Ralph Wenge and Asiye Namdar, only on CNN.
One of the things we were talking about during the break, a lot of people wonder, what do you talk about during the break? We were talking about one of the most difficult things about getting older is forgetting things. And a lot of people make, I have fun with you, comics have had fun with the people. Is that for you frustrating to not remember something?
Yes, it's very frustrating. And yet at the same time, I don't know whether it's all just the passage of the years. Incidentally, you referred to that birthday that is coming up. I don't call them birthdays anymore. They are anniversaries of your 39th birthday.
Oh.
And this will be the 41st anniversary of
your 39th. Yeah. So you're a kid. And the library should open around February 6th, right?
Yes.
Oh. Yeah, that's okay, what about forgetting things?
Well, I think, for example, on names. It's the number, and as they accumulate. For example, it's something like 1,200 people in the executive branch there at the White House. Now, you meet them, and you recognize them, and you know them, and so forth, and you hear their name. And now, day after day goes on, and you come up to them in the halls and so forth, and seeing the meeting, but you've heard their name once. And you know them, and you know what job they're doing and all, but you have to go back and look it up to remember that name that you only
heard. But you can remember
once.
A movie from 1942 and know who the 12th star was in that film. I mean, you have great memory when it goes back, right?
Well, sometimes I've been surprised when I've looked at a movie that I made quite some time ago. And what really surprises me is, yes, I remember that movie and the whole story and everything, except there'll come a scene on there in which I'm involved. And I'll find that I have no memory whatsoever of doing that particular scene. And it bothers me.
How is your health?
Oh, I'm sound. I'm of good health.
Nancy told us the other night, and we may never have known this, how close you came to dying. She said three times close.
Yes, that was when I was shot.
Were you aware that you were that close?
No. Had no time. And it was a surprise to me afterward to be told how close I came, the amount of blood that I had lost. You know, I got to the hospital, got out of the car myself, the first one out of the car, and walked into the emergency entrance and met a nurse who was coming toward me and told her I was having a little trouble breathing. I still didn't know I'd been shot.
We interrupt. There's been a late development. Shots reported fired outside the hotel where President Reagan spoke a short while ago. Here's Bernard Shaw in our Washington bureau.
Bob,
as you can understand, details are very sketchy. We don't know precisely what happened, nor... Pardon me. Okay, my apology.
The White House has confirmed now, just in the last few minutes, that President Reagan has indeed been shot. His condition is listed as stable, which we understand means all his vital signs are normal and that he is in good condition.
The President of the United States is quoted as telling his wife at his hospital bed, "Honey, I forgot to duck."
On CNN.com, machines that think like humans and even have a personality all their own. A look into the mind of artificial intelligence. What some bots may soon be doing for you. Only on CNN.
CNN's family of websites has a new member. CNNItalia.it. World news, Italian news, business, sport, and lifestyle.
This is literally a flying laboratory.
Live from Mogadishu.
Full coverage is now available in-depth in Italian in an instant. CNNItalia.it. Constantly updated 24 hours a day. Accessible wherever you are in the world. CNN Interactive. Bringing the world to your fingertips.
CNN.com and IDG.net offer you the latest technology news, product reviews, and all the essentials to survive in the digital age. Get it all at CNN.com/technology in association with IDG.net.
My grandfather once he bought a radio, small radio, you know, and it was strange for us. All the people come around and look to the radio. That's like 50 years ago. Now we have the internet, and we have the satellite dish, and we have the mobiles. If there are something happened now in the United States, less than 1 minute we know about this. But before, maybe we don't know even about it, maybe 1 year. The life now, it's like a small village. All the world are a small village now. But with the information, you are a human. So you can't control your life even. There are many things to see. There are good things, there are bad things. But we took the good things from the other culture. Now you can't live without information. The human without information is nothing.
For our country's future, I pledge you my every effort. I ask for your prayers and your support. I believe that together, we can keep this rendezvous with destiny.
We, at one time in your administration, this comes out quite a bit, supported Saddam Hussein.
Yes.
What, do you look back at that now regretfully?
Well, we didn't know as much about him as we know now, and the opponent that he had, Iran under Khomeini, was, we thought, pretty lacking in some of the nicer sides of life and all. So there was a tendency to, even though we officially were neutral and all, inwardly you cannot help but think the fellow that's fighting Khomeini and Iran must be the right guy.
A lesser of two evils.
Yes.
So no regrets.
No regrets.
Were you shocked when he went into Kuwait?
Yes, the whole brutal way in which that was done. And just in here was this small country. And, you know, again, about the thing where people are talking about if there's a war and so forth, it's over oil. Yes, Iraq's goal was oil. But I think our interest there is the savage attack on a small country that wasn't doing anything wrong to anyone. That is what we have to counter. That's what this problem is all about. Never mind oil. It's the inhuman act that was committed.
Do you think she would attack Israel, as her foreign minister said yesterday she would? Do you think Iraq would attack Israel if attacked?
I certainly hope not. And I have to question whether they would. I hope on the other side that Israel stands firm and doesn't join in any activity.
Do you think Israel has equated itself well so far?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Our guest, the former president of the United States, Ronald Reagan. The book is An American Life, and your calls come next. Don't go away.
Hello, I'm Glenn Van Zutphen at the CNN Center. We have an update for you now on the situation in Central America, which was shaken by a major earthquake. We're just getting in the first pictures from El Salvador. This video comes from the suburbs of the capital, San Salvador. It shows a landslide caused by the 7.6 magnitude quake, which covered an estimated 950,000 houses in two villages. Even the Red Cross is not estimating the number of people killed beyond the dozen or so bodies recovered so far. It says it has some 3,000 rescue and medical personnel in El Salvador, but it's dark right now, and 80% of San Salvador is reported to be without electricity. So any major rescue effort will have to wait until first light. A Red Cross spokesman says every hospital in and around the capital is full, and more victims are coming in all the time. According to the Red Cross, medical supplies are holding up at this time, but it anticipates it will soon need money just to carry on the operation of such a huge task. Stay tuned to CNN for the latest on the earthquake in Central America.
Tomorrow night on Larry King Live, H. Ross Perot will be with us. On Monday night, Senator Bob Kerry of Nebraska. Our guest is the former president of the United States, Ronald Reagan. We're going to go to your phone calls. Two things I do want to cover. Newsweek magazine reports that there is anger among many Republican conservatives over the way they feel you're being treated by President Bush, that you're being kind of avoided. Are they wrong?
Well, I think so, yes. I know there's a limit to what a president can do and how busy he is and all. And
You don't feel avoided?
No.
We go to Ocala, Florida for President Reagan. Hello.
Good evening, Mr. President.
Good evening.
I'd like to begin by saying thank you for the 8 years of leadership you gave this country. It was truly a blessing to have you. My question is, I would like to hear your opinion on reinstituting the draft.
Well, thank you very much for your kind words. And my opinion with regard to reinstituting the draft is no. We've been so successful with regard to simply having, opening the ranks and people choosing to join that I prefer that. Now, it's possible that sometime there could come a hostile situation in which you might be forced to draft if there is any letdown in the rest, but we haven't had any trouble with getting recruits.
Do you miss Washington?
I miss a lot of the people there. I suppose maybe I might have more missed it if I had known from the very beginning that there was a limit due to that constitutional amendment that was put through, so that you knew that at a time certain you were to leave. But when I say miss the people, yes. For example, in the White House, the people in the White House there, the care of you and your lifestyle and all, they have a spirit and a pride about what they're doing, that you miss them when they're not there.
I imagine there are things you don't miss, though.
Well, that's right. Yeah.
Like the press. you had a good time with the press, didn't you? You got along well.
Well, there seemed to be a hostility. There was an I felt, and I think properly, that in every press conference there was an adversarial relationship. They weren't there to get just some news. They were there to trap me into some kind of boner.
What is their job?
I think their job is to be totally responsible. And I'm afraid that sometimes they have goals of their own. And they aren't as responsible as they should be. For example, some of the things that take place when there is a hostile situation, and the press comes forth with a story, and they say they can't name the source of the story, that this has been denied them the right to do. And then they say something that must be of great value to the enemy. They reveal secret movements and so forth. This was why, with regard to the Grenada experience, I kept that the best and most total secret in all of the 8 years. I didn't even tell my own press secretary. I didn't tell anyone, because Cuba, with its forces, was so much closer to Grenada. And the whole situation there was the communists had seized by power the government of Grenada, and in fact had murdered some of the government people. And I made this such a total secret.
Do you think the press would have revealed that you were going to attack, had they known?
I think if there had been a leak, yes.
Margaret Thatcher is coming over for, we learned today, for your opening of your library.
Yes. I've just learned it recently myself.
That's a great feather in your cap.
Well, I have a great respect for her, and she did a wonderful job in England, and I guess was the longest prime minister serving that they had.
We go to Los Angeles for President Reagan. Hello.
Yes, I'd like to know, Mr. President, why there was just a Band-Aid put on the SNL bailout situation. Why during your administration you never told the American public exactly what was going on there?
Because I didn't know what was going on there. That entire thing, so many agencies and departments and so forth of government, and you're dependent on these people to bring you up to date on something that's going on. Well, I was never notified of any great problem or trouble with the savings and loans.
So you're as surprised by this as we are.
Yes.
Our guest, the former President of the United States, Ronald Reagan, the book An American Life, is published by Simon & Schuster. We'll take a break, come back, and get to lots more phone calls. This is Larry King Live in Los Angeles with Ronald Reagan. Don't go away.
You find this hard to believe, but with all of these early morning meetings and everything else, we have managed to keep one thing in the administration from leaking. And at 5:15 this morning, the joint force landed at two spots on Grenada. Paratroopers in the south, Marines and other multiple force in the north, secured both airports. They're 8 miles apart, the one at the south tip of the island, and then the operational one, the one that the Cubans have been building, is up further north.
Hello, my name is John Price. I'm from Melbourne, Australia. And my question is, why is the presidential term limited to 8 years?
Until Franklin D. Roosevelt, there was no limitation on the number of terms that a president could serve. But Roosevelt was elected four times. There are any number of people who are not enamored of Roosevelt who felt that that should be changed, and they were successful. Now, there can only be two terms, and every time a president who's been successful and gotten reelected to that second term comes to the end of his term, you hear some wistful comments about why couldn't this person serve another. Since FDR, there have been some presidents who have made it clear that they believe they could have won had they tried, most notably Ronald Reagan and now Bill Clinton.
This week on Inside Europe, NATO under pressure. We take a look at growing European concerns about the use of depleted uranium-tipped weapons in the Balkans. An issue which has refocused attention on Gulf War veterans who say their lives have been destroyed by the syndrome. And row on the rock. Why Spain wants this stricken British submarine to leave Gibraltar. That's Inside Europe, only on CNN.
Behind every headline, there is the whole story.
more intriguing, more complex, more compelling. I'm Jonathan Mann. Insight looks at the world from a broader perspective and presents different points of view so you can focus on the big picture. Insight, changing the way you look at your world, only on CNN.
That a lot of American people just simply don't believe you. But the one thing that you've had going for you more than anything else in your presidency, your credibility, has been severely damaged. Can you repair it? What does it mean for the rest of your presidency?
Well, I imagine I'm the only one around who wants to repair it, and I didn't have anything to do with damaging it.
Before we get back to the calls, you discussed the press and Grenada and how you kept it from your own press secretary. How do you view press coverage of the Gulf? Would you limit that? Would you keep things from us if you were president about tactics there?
Well, I think anything that could conceivably give information that would be beneficial to a prospective enemy, no, that shouldn't be done. And yet there are, as we go back into the past and even to World War II, there were times when the press, I remember when a ship went out of New York of ours headed for Iceland, a liner that didn't even have a gun on the deck or didn't have any military escort, but it had some thousands of American troops on, and they were going there to, and we weren't in the war yet, but the submarine packs were all up and down the Atlantic. And all of a sudden, one of the major newspapers in New York came out with the news that this ship with these soldiers was on its way to Iceland. And it was almost like an invitation for a wolf pack of those submarines to come in.
How do you balance it? Don't you think that the press would be responsible that if you called in, if you're the president, the heads of CNN and ABC and NBC and the New York Times and the Washington Post and said, listen, fellas, this is gonna take place on Thursday. You can help us. We can lose a lot of lives if you break this. Don't you think they'd work with you?
Well, I don't know, because when you start doing that, you can't control who all hears this or learns of it. I found that Washington was leaked like a sieve. Almost anything that was going on, there were leaks. And always there would be that the person who would reveal the information's name could not be given. And I can't tell you how many times I had to get on the phone and call a head of state of another allied country of ours and apologize and explain to the head of state that this was not true, because it could have been very offensive to that individual, tell him that this was not true and I was just sorry that such a story came out.
Do you see any danger at all in television's coverage so far of this crisis?
No, I don't believe I have. I think the people are interested and they want to see and hear, but as I say, I do think that there could be less U.S. versus Saddam Hussein and more it's U.N.
Well, some might say, though, that President Bush has made it that way. He's the one that's been the most active of the world leaders, one talking the most about Hussein,
well,
is George Bush.
But also because he's a prominent part of the United Nations also. The United Nations isn't a separate thing. It's a collection of countries and governments.
You're saying then if we say we're not the one that's going to say go, if we go on January 19th or February 3rd, it's the UN that's saying go.
I think it should be the United Nations. And I hope that they're responsive to that responsibility that they have.
Oh, so you're saying it's not George Bush who's going to push this button?
Well, I've never discussed it with him. There might be some reason why.
If you were in that boat tonight, you would call someone else. In other words, it would be a UN person who would make this decision.
Well, I would.
On the hypothetical.
Yeah, I can't answer that, because not being there and not in that situation and never having had the thing of the United Nations in a situation of this kind, I just don't know what my position would be.
There's a man that you brought to prominence in public life that now every American knows. He was your national security advisor. What do you think about the job that Colin Powell is doing?
I think it's a great job. I think he's a very remarkable man. I was greatly impressed with him when he was, and the way he thought, when he was my advisor. And I had the pleasure and the honor of putting stars on him and to be a general. And I think that we have a remarkably fine man as our commanding general.
How about some of the other key players? Are you happy with Secretary Baker?
Well, yes, yes. He seems to be doing all that he can.
Mr. Cheney?
Yes.
I note, though, from the answers that Powell's your favorite of this group.
Well, I have a personal a great admiration of him and a personal feeling of friendship.
In a wartime situation, no doubt that he would be a great leader?
Yes, he would. Yes.
We'll be right back with Ronald Reagan. An American Life from Simon & Schuster is out. More calls after this.
I know I shouldn't say this, but I have a confession to make. I just might have had an ulterior motive for inviting Colin Powell up here today to my presidential library. You see, I am hoping that perhaps one day he'll return the favor and invite me to his.
Monday on CNN and Time, they were victims of a massacre.
I stood up and I remember saying, I'm dead, I'm dead, I'm dead.
The gunman used a weapon that critics say was designed and marketed to appeal to violent people. Plus, at many of our universities, is justice a one-way street?
No one tells you that when you attend these schools, you're giving away your rights.
CNN and Time on CNN.
On the next Q&A, Tiananmen Papers editor Andrew J. Nathan will talk about the documents reportedly revealing the decision-making behind China's 1989 crackdown at Tiananmen Square. Your questions by phone, fax, and email on Q&A, only on CNN. Sunday on Business Unusual. It's one of the oldest industries and one that's assured a long life, the funeral business. We look at how baby boomers are putting their mark on the final passage. Plus, in the small town of Chimayo, New Mexico, one woman has made a business out of feeding the faithful, a profile of Leona and her tortilla empire. On Business Unusual, defining the new economy, in association with Arthur Anderson on CNN.
The global economy is constantly changing, and CNN's Biz Asia keeps you on the cutting edge of it all, with interviews from Asia's top financial leaders and live reports from across the region. Biz Asia, only on CNN.
Our guest is President Reagan. We go to Ocala, Florida. Hello.
Yes, Mr. Reagan, how did you feel the night that you left office and you were riding on the helicopter, you and Mrs. Reagan? What were your emotions? How long did it take you to get back into the stream of things? And that's my question.
Yeah, what was that like?
Well, I have said already that knowing that you had to leave in advance wasn't like, say, being defeated and ousted or something. But then, and I shall always have a warm feeling in my heart for that Marine pilot, we got on Marine One. It had been the presidential helicopter to go out to the airport, to the air base, and take off for California. Well, the pilot, circled at a very low level Washington there, and we could see the parade forming and things of that kind. And then, at the lowest point of altitude, he circled the White House. And as Nancy said the other night on here, said the same thing about what I said I did. I said, look, honey, there's our little shack down there. Well, Yes, there had to be a feeling about that because life was most comfortable. And again, as I say, those people were so wonderful in the White House that we knew we were missing a lot of people that we thought of as very good and sound friends.
Mr. President, do you think your wife got a bad rap? We talked about it the other night, her and the press and...
Oh, yes. And I think it was because of a kind of an opposition to me and everything I stood for that they picked on her.
You think it reflected off you rather than just picking on her?
Well, I think that they, that was part of their trying to get even with me.
How did you feel when that was happening? Were you defensive?
Well,
were you
I
angry?
Was mad. Completely mad.
It's hard to picture you mad.
Well, the outright dishonesty of things. For example, the thing that she mentioned on the China that was ordered. And she was accused over and over again of spending the taxpayers' money on this very expensive set. Now, I have to tell you that the China for the White House has to be able to provide for about 120 people. And we had discovered that because even at those high polluting affairs, there are people who want souvenirs. So come with a normal breakage, but also some souvenirs that at a state dinner with 120 people in the state dining room, we had a multiple sets of china. you couldn't serve one. These people put together and had that set created and donated it. Oh. Gave it as a gift to the nation.
Prominent Americans steal china?
Huh? Yes, I guess so.
Westwood, California, with Ronald Reagan. Hello.
Mr. President, please accept my comments on your wonderful presidency. I have been working with General John T. Chain and General Larry D. Welsh to save the B-2 bomber. You recently made a visit to Palmdale to see it. Please give us your comments and whatever you can to boost it.
Well, I think very highly of it, of course, and I...
This is camp, didn't Cheney just...
And I put it back into use after it had been grounded. And I think that this and things of this kind reflect our great technology, our technological superiority over so many potential enemies.
You disagree with cuts, then?
That what?
You disagree with cuts in it.
Well, yes, although I understand that with all the overspending that's done and the national deficit, the only place where the Congress ever seems to show a desire to cut is in military. When I took office, I found that on any given day, 50% of our military aircraft couldn't fly for lack of spare parts. Now, this is just disgraceful. And as I say, that's the only place where they seem to want to cut. Every budget that I submitted, they put on the shelf and said it was dead on arrival. Then they would send back to me a continuing resolution, which was their form of budget. Every time, my budget was far lower than the money they wanted to spend.
We're hopscotching in lots of places. Are you surprised Gorbachev has hung on this long?
Well, yes, because, you know, that vested aristocracy there, all of those Politburo members and so forth, they're frightened that a change in the system is going to take away their perquisites, just as he closed down their private stores where they could go in without waiting in line, and they could choose from any one of a half a dozen meats where the Russian citizens had to stand hours in line and there would only be one kind of meat when they did get in the store.
Did you like him right away?
I'll tell you, that there was something, because having known previous leaders, there were three before he came along, they kept dying on me. And in our first meeting, as we came together with my team and his team, I had told our people what I was going to do. And that was, as we started to sit down, I said to him, why don't you and I let our teams start this discussion and you and I go out and get some fresh air? He was out of his chair before I finished the sentence. So we walked down to the edge of the lake, where there was a kind of a house there, a bathhouse that belonged to the building where we were together. And we went in, and we had a little conversation. We had to have interpreters, but we had a little conversation between us. And
you liked him right away?
Yes. And I told him, for example, that we were there. I said, we don't mistrust each other because we're armed. This is a quote of someone else. We're armed because we mistrust each other. So in addition to talking about reducing the weaponry and so forth, why don't we see if we can't reduce the causes of mistrust? And I said, the only thing left to us otherwise is to go back to an arms race. And then I made my declaration. I looked him right in the eye and said, and that's a race you can't win. There is no way we're going to allow you to maintain a superiority in weapons over us.
We'll be right back with former President Ronald Reagan on Larry King Live. H. Ross Perot tomorrow night. Don't go away.
Stop! Wait! There are now two answers to this question. One, it's a stick that comes back when you throw it. But now it's also Cartoon Network's other channel that shows the best cartoons of all time, all the time. So there you go. There are now two boomerangs in the world for you to enjoy. Just don't get them the wrong way round. Boomerang, the new channel from Cartoon Network, now available on digital satellite.
Recently on Showbiz This Weekend.
No one can tell me that I'm doing wrong, buddy.
What kind of year has 2000 been for James Taylor? A rewarding one.
A Grammy for the last album, and then a Billboard Century Award, and then the Songwriters Hall of Fame and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
His Hall of Fame induction was presided over by Paul McCartney, the guy who gave him his first record deal on the Apple label in 1968.
It was, very generous of him to respond to my letter and say, sure, I'll come over and read you in. It was a surprise that he would do that. But it was also a surprise that he listened to my demo tape in 1968 and said, yeah, we'll sign this guy. Why not?
Showbiz This Weekend, Sundays and Mondays on CNN.
Our guest, President Reagan, with us by phone from Amman, Jordan, heading for Baghdad, is CNN's Bernard Shaw. Are you there, Bernie?
Yes, Larry, I'm here.
Okay, the president can hear you. Remember,
yes,
Bernie Shaw? Well, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Bernie.
Mr. President, as I head into Baghdad to sit down at President Saddam Hussein, I have two questions for you. One, would you do what President George Bush is doing in this crisis? And two, what would you like to ask Saddam Hussein at this point in this critical crisis?
Well, you've given me two questions. The first one here, I don't see that I can answer about this unless you're actually there and know every shade of things that are going on. Can you say what you would or would not do? But I do believe, with all my heart, that unless there is a withdrawal, we have no choice but to use force to get Saddam Hussein's forces out of Kuwait.
And he might be watching right now.
Well, yes, and he asked me...
That's what you'd say to him.
Yes.
We're not kidding.
No, that's... But he has to know that that's what would be done. Now, was that answering...
Is that okay, Bernie?
Ask a question, Bernie.
That's fine with me, and I'm certain that during the interview with President Saddam, whenever it occurs, Sunday or Monday, or maybe after the deadline, I will put that question to the president of Iraq.
Well, Let's hope.
To him, yes, but I think that he should know what he's up against and what he's facing.
Hey, Bernie, good luck, and don't take any risks.
No, Larry, and Mr. Reagan, I'm very conservative when it comes to danger and the potential threat against life.
Think well, Bernie. We need you back
here. Thank you.
Thank you. We go to Orlando, Florida for Ronald Reagan. Hello.
Hello. President, my question is, do you think that there will be an uprising in the Soviet Union?
Do I think there will be an uprising in the Soviet Union? It's difficult for me to believe that that will happen. I do know that the greatest opposition to Gorbachev is coming from the system, from the Politburo, from the bureaucrats. You know, any bureaucracy, its cause is protect the bureaucracy. But he knows, he came into office and discovered that he had inherited an economic basket case, and mainly because of the great military buildup. So he set about to bring back an economy, an honest economy, to the Soviet Union. And now, more and more, it has become apparent to them and apparent to a number of the people in the streets. We were there a few weeks ago, that our system, the system of free enterprise, is what they really should be having. And I know that Gorbachev is very interested in bringing about the private ownership of Soviet land. As you know now, every inch of land is owned by the government. And he is trying to bring about things. I know one thing that he wants to bring about is to see if he can't get these vast tracts of land that are used for the collective farms, the government-owned farms, to get those divided up into private farming plots and let them be privately farmed by the Russian farmers.
Do you think he'll succeed?
I have to believe he will, because when we were there, it was unbelievable. For example, in Leningrad, the people of Lenin are literally storming in the streets. They want their city renamed St. Petersburg for the man who built the city. And in the streets, if they find a place where there's a bust or a statue or something of Lenin, they throw it down in the street and smash it. Nothing seems to happen to them for doing this. We went on Sunday morning. We went to church with 1,000 Russians. Only a short time ago, you couldn't be a communist in the Soviet Union if you didn't sign a pledge that you were an atheist.
We'll be right back with our remaining few moments with Ronald Reagan after this.
We're not just grateful to both you and Mrs. Gorbachev, but want you to know we think of you as friends. And in that spirit, we would ask one further favor of you. Tell the people of the Soviet Union of the deep feelings of friendship felt by us and by the people of our country toward them.
CNN World News brings in-depth coverage of the latest regional and international news stories as they unfold. World Business This Week recaps happenings on the financial front, giving you the competitive edge in business. Stay ahead. Stay tuned to CNN.
On CNN.com, machines that think like humans and even have a personality all their own. A look into the mind of artificial intelligence, what some bots may soon be doing for you, only on CNN.
Sunday, CNN's late edition with Wolf Blitzer. Informative, in-depth, and live. Featuring today's biggest newsmakers. Late edition, Sunday on CNN.
Table 4.
isn't Europe weird different? CNN.com Europe is different. It's CNN's world news, just seen from Europe.
A couple of quick things. On a personal note, do you miss Santa Barbara? The ranch?
Well, I've always missed the ranch. I love that ranch up there. But I've arranged with our scheduling people that unless something serious intervenes, that every month I'll have a little period of a few days up at the ranch. I can live with that.
And we have a minute left, and what does one say? February 6th, you'll be 80 years old. What do you think is going to happen in the next week or so? I mean, just in reflection, are you...
I can't. Honestly, this whole thing here is hanging there such that I can't visualize Saddam Hussein suddenly turning around and doing the things that we're trying to get with the sanctions and so forth. Therefore, and I don't have enough information as to when is the proper moment to take the action.
Yes.
But I think that we're going to have to, and I believe that's going to be the end result.
Will you come back on your 90th birthday? Your 42nd anniversary of your 39th.
Why, I'd be delighted to.
We replayed this interview with Ronald Reagan tonight because of the injury yesterday and the surgery today at St. John's Hospital. On behalf of all of us at CNN, we extend our best wishes to the former president and his lovely wife, Nancy. See you Monday night with Elizabeth Taylor. Thanks for joining us and good night.
Do you have an opinion about something you've seen on CNN?